I don't know how many was coming, we didn't expect to plan for 50. But we'll take everybody that we get because this is a new program. And my name is John Myers. I am City Council Building Official. And I want to introduce you to my colleague Denise. Denise is going to be the coordinator for, office coordinator for all the new developing code enforcement division. And so she'll be with us tonight, and you'll be able to ask her perfect questions. You'll see most of her when you come to the office. When you come to a phone call, it will go directly to her. But if there's any other insinuations or complaints, the buck stops at my table. So I'm here to kind of tell you what happened. I've been the person who designed the program, but I want to start with giving you a background on why the city changed its protocol and procedures. And so I'm going to start and blame all of this new program on City Council. Just so everybody knows, it's all on City Council.
It is.
And the mayor.
Well, in July of 2022, they made a strategic strategy plan. And then they submitted to where it needed to be developed and created. And in the first objective and the second objective, I was hoping mine would be like in the seventh or eighth, but it didn't. The first objective and the second objective, I'm actually reading from their written, finalized, codified, approved strategy. And their first statement was, we need to increase the cleanliness of our city's business districts. The second objective, and I left the details out of that, but the second objective was to increase the cleanliness and the sanitational systems of light in our neighborhoods. Project one and project two directly implies that the building department needs to redesign and restructure how we are about cleaning up and bringing all of our city of 5 square miles and roughly 40,000 people and roughly 17,000 parcels between resident and business back to a clean and healthy environment for today and into the future. So let me start with a real short version. When it came to the business, we have three things that we're working on. The first agenda after we got the 22 strategy is we wrote the program to reevaluate all of our business certificate of occupancies. Second phase would be to evaluate and bring to code all of our business signing issues. And third level would be to bring all of our businesses that are vacant and aren't in compliance with their vacant registrations and vacant use of their buildings to compliance with the city ordinances that are established. So those are the three phases we started with for businesses. If you're not sure how it went, in the first year that we started it with certificate of occupancies, we started with roughly 48.7% of our business works were registered in the city having the document of certification. By the time we got to the end of the first year, first phase, we are now sitting between 94, depending on what street we're on, and 97% of all of our operating businesses are now certified, and we have walked through them with health and safety in the fire and health and safety in the building department. So now we really can speak a lot more boldly about the conditions of our business districts and our businesses that are presently operating. Now we're going to work on, as of a year ago, we'll start this second phase, which is in signs, and hopefully this spring we'll begin a proposal to council of how to run the program for evaluating and processing all of our commercial vacant businesses. And right now we have a significant number of those that we need to get in line with what the city wants us to do. So there's the first strategy. Tonight's subject's really going to be about what can we do to revitalize the blight of conditions and house structures in our neighborhoods and our residential. To give you an idea, there's roughly, and I'm really getting it down to just a few numbers, 14,400 residential parcels. So most of our property is driven by our tax base, is driven by our residential properties. But we have some things we have to work out, and we'll talk about them as we get into it. But what we were doing prior to the change is we were using all of our code enforcement programming through the what was known then as Lincoln Park Pride. It was a division out of the city police department. In fact, for how many years, Denise, were you on that program?
15.
She was there as an officer for 15 years. She will testify that the approach that they took was somebody gave you a call and you went out and inspected the problem. So it was complaint driven when it came to residential blight. It wasn't driven on parking issues for animals, but it was on building issues. It was complaint driven. We've removed that complaint policy as a primary. Not that we're going to, you can call in, you can complain, and she'll still process it and get it through the doors. However, we've shifted to the complaints going, why are you picking on me when you haven't picked on my neighbor? Or forwarders now, did you see the house on the other block? And so what we've done is we've moved the program into the building department. We've opened space in the first floor so we could host two full-time field operators and Denise as the coordinator. And now the plan is to cover the entire city as frequently, as often as we can based on what we are going to do. The actual date of opening started August 7th. And between August 7th and today, which is 6 months tomorrow, we've only did violations on items that would be homeowner sweat equity. In other words, you don't necessarily put a lot of money in it, but you're going to have to cut your grass. You're going to have to keep your lawn cut right. You're going to have to clean the alley that belongs to you based on the ordinance of where it connects. It is not city responsibility on these vacant properties. They are your properties. And so we've gone door to door to door to door to door to...
How many now, Denise, do you know that we've gone to?
Alley letters, we've given out 902 as of last week Friday.
So we are literally trying to have a watch the phrase here, we're really putting together a registry of how many homes we have that are legally responsible for a piece of an alley that they live up against. And so we're at 900 and some at this point. The letter writes two different ways. It writes, if your alley needs clean, please go do it. We'll give you time. And tell us that you got it clean, we'll come back and check. But if you already keep it clean, the bottom of the letter says, thank you very much. That's what we anticipate for everyone to keep rat animals infestation and all the other problems that come with overgrowth in an alley, especially even when you can't get through for emergency vehicles or utility issues. So thank you. So we've already given you an idea. In 6 months, we've visited over 900 houses, and we've actually posted them. So the first step, everything that we do going forward will be that when we get to your house, we will give you the letter of concern that we have about your property. And it'll tell you what your legal responsibilities are. There will be five things on that you should notice every time you get the letter. There should be your address. It should be the violation written based on a code number. There should be the error of responsibility of time which to take care of it. And then there should be a contact information for who you should contact to get your resolution solved. And number five is there should be an appeal approach. There should be some place that says, hey, I don't agree that this should be my responsibility. How do you appeal that? What is the process to disagree with whoever put that letter on your house? Those five things should be on all the letters that go into your properties. And that's what we're designing. And so we're training it, retraining it, and retraining it with our officers. And that's how we're going. So up to now, 6 months, we've been spending it on sweat equity. Things that you need to just move or change or clean. Alleys was the first step we took on. Then we went to properties that have been parking recreational vehicles on their property too close to their houses to meet the city's health safety code for putting a trailer or a boat or snowmobiles or whatever else with gas in them beside a house or beside a garage. The third area we've addressed in the vehicles is when you decide to, or family members decide to put cars on property that doesn't have a hard surface. So if you haven't noticed, every once in a while you'll find a car that's not being used sitting on the grass beside the garage. Nope, can't do that, because that's a hard surface and we need that water to drain through the ground. The city doesn't permit you to park a vehicle or an inoperable vehicle on a surface that isn't hard, concrete or pavement. And so we're busily working at this winter months to try to find a way that says, we just need to move that. It's no money, just get it out of here, because it's a violation to health and safety of this whole neighborhood. The next level that we went to was, it's a soft one, it's not very often, we don't see too many, but some of our houses still don't have addresses on them. Or some of our houses don't have addresses that you could read anymore. But if we're going to be first responders, I need to make sure my side of the responsibility as a building official makes sure that they can know right where they're going. So we're saying, here's the code, here's the state law, and I'm going to just make sure that you figure out how to get those numbers on your house or on the porch so that anybody driving by can see you. And so we're there at that phase. That was the fifth thing that we're trying to do. And the final one we worked through in the last winter, the last part of this winter months, is if you have a fence that is collapsed, dilapidated, not working, it can't be repaired, it would have to be replaced or restored, and it's already tied onto another fence, it's not about you're not going to have protection from your neighbor because there's a metal fence there. Take that fence off. Don't have to replace it yet. You can replace it in one spring if you want. But remove it because it's blight. We can't take care of that with it. And it's illegal to tie one fence to another fence. So get rid of that so everybody has uniformity. The other thing we want our officers and our citizens to know in this program is this is proactive. We're going out and looking. We're following the city ordinance, following the legal guidelines. We're not stepping on properties that we're not legally allowed to. We're not doing our illegal trespasses. But in the same breath, we want you to know that when you're mad because you've seen this slime ball four houses away, we're coming to them too. We're not going to leave anybody off the wind. We want to be proactive and take a look at your whole block, your whole neighborhood, and begin to figure out if we're going to start working on a particular topic of violations, we're going to look at that whole block before we leave town. And then we're going to keep getting to the next block. So right now we have two officers that are covering 50% of the city each. And we're not letting them split. We'll shift them along the line. So there's the five things we've done up to this point in 6 months. Everything's been designed to be sweat active. But now we want to introduce you to where we're going next. And here's where we are into April, into March. When we get to, so we're already halfway through February, when we get to March and April, weather will have broken. So now we have the ability to introduce to the city the next level of accountability for bringing property values up. So here's the list, and they're really kind of bizarrely different, but they're property things. So if you have a shed in the backyard, but you have a blue tarp on it, that blue tarp isn't the way it was meant to be built. If you have a garage with a blue tarp on the front door, the garage door wasn't meant to be a blue tarp. So you have to at least remove it or repair or replace that. The state of Michigan, excuse me for just a moment, the state of Michigan and the city of Lincoln Park has authorized and codified that this is the book that determines what property maintenance is going to be established by. And so what I've provided for you tonight is a copy of Chapter 3.0, Chapter 3.7, Chapter 3.8. These are outside issues. So if you have a neighbor and you already know that they have a garage that isn't painted and it's rotting away and the side of the roof is falling off, but I can't get into it, we get to your house, you're welcome to tell us, hey, you can use my property and take a look at my backyard, because you'll see the neighbor's garage twisted. When that's a problem, we have the right to ask them to repair, replace, or remove. And that's what we're going to do. Because until we do that, we're not going to improve property values across the entire city. So for your benefit tonight, as a preliminary, I've provided a written copy of some of those fundamentals so you'll take one sheet of each and then pass the rest around. Because then you'll really know where we're getting our codes from and you don't have to guess. You don't have to find it online anywhere. You don't have to chase it down. But you'll have the preliminaries. As we go into the spring and we start looking at fences, we're going to take a look at steps and the porches that are broken and aren't really safe to walk on anymore. We're going to address another one that's going to be unique is when, and it's really, you'll find it in chapter 3, but example, the state law says if you have a residential house and you have a porch and you have four steps to it, you need a handrail. One, we're going to require that because you don't only have family that goes to that house, you have delivery companies that go to the house, you have postal people, you have maintenance people, you have neighbors. So we're going to ask you to put that safety rail on that porch. Interesting enough, you'll see some in the city, I already do already, you'll see some porches that don't have any handrails on them, railings on the porch at all. The law says if you have something over 30 inches, you need a railing because if somebody falls, that's a height enough to break bones. And so that's what we're going to put. And I'm not making it up because I don't like people. It's coming out of the state code that the city council has codified and required us to do. So I want you to have a copy so as you go home and as you talk about this, you'll know where we're getting our information. If there's any other kind of, and I'm only talking really to these two residents, but if there's any other details that you don't know, you're calling our corporate office and you're going to be able to ask her to give you a clarification. You don't agree, she gets to say, I'll give you a clarification. The truth of the matter is that our letters from our officers should already tell you what reference that code is coming from and what the violation is. But if you disagree, she'll be glad to be the defending argument and defense for the city. If you don't think she's telling you straight, you always get to a bill and write me a letter, write me an email, send me a note, leave it on a napkin, put it on my desk and say, call me because I don't agree and I want you to review this case. The summer where it's going to get ugly, it does because we're going to still work through it, is the biggest thing when we get to the summer will be people that don't want to cut their grass. And it's because maybe they're a long distance landlord, or maybe because they're vacated and the house is empty and no one's there to pay attention to it. And then people get upset when we get to 8 inches and then they think they should get a cut. We have a contract right now with the city. The city has a contract with a lawn service. And I'm begging, just look at me straight in the eye because we have to work out the details. I'm begging you, don't let them cut your grass. Because you could go buy a lawnmower for their price. Okay, you could buy your own mower and cut it with you, have your paid $10 every other week for your neighbor to buy it at 10 years old and cut your front lawn as small as these are, than to let this company come do it. But I have to coach you to go, don't let it happen because the only option you have to cleaning up the neighborhood and not letting grass go too tall. And what we've learned, my experience with the city this summer and this fall, was we won't this year allow that grass to get over 8-9 inches. Sometimes we were cutting it at a foot and a half. The reason was because before we got here, there was only call complaints. There wasn't somebody driving the neighborhood every day. I knew years ago when I was in a city, I used to have two city council members who were crazy and they were just nuts. And they would drive all around the neighborhood and look for tags and signs and then call and drop by the building department and go, look what I found in the neighborhood. What are you going to do about it? I don't know what city that was or the people anymore, but yeah, they were crazy. But we don't have those kinds of complaint calls anymore. We're going to be proactive and drive the neighborhood. So we'll know where our 8 inches get there so the grass doesn't become a disaster for anyone. And it's the same thing with our alleys. So we'll pick up a lot more vegetation issues when we get to the summer, but we will still work on improving the quality of household stock. So accessory buildings, according to the state law, is a really weird term because it sounds like a building, but it also includes driveways, porches, and fences. Those are all legal terms for accessory structures. And so those are part of what we're going to work at cleaning. If your fence is up properly, but is all weathered, we're not going to ask you to take it down. We're going to ask you to paint it. We're going to ask you to seal it, make it good again. If it's not broken, pieces aren't all falling off, it's not all worked out, but we're going to ask you to refinish it so that it stays longer so you don't have to tear it apart. But everything that's on the outside of your building, now have the right to invite you to keep it up to standards. Some people are forgetting, even in their garages, their wooden garages yet, but they haven't been painted, they're peeling. The code says you must keep it weathered and tight. And so when you're not keeping your garage, because you don't see the back of it very often, it's only seen from the alley. We're going to ask your neighbors to make their garages weather tight. You don't have to seal it with new siding, but you're going to have to be asked to paint it, because that's keeping the property value rising and stabilized and growing. So there's the foundation of what we're going. We're going from reaction on phone calls to proactive, that we're sending people through the entire city every single day, 80 hours a week, they'll be in the field looking at property for light. So when we get to warm weather, guess what we're going to do? We're going to go back to alleys, back to signs and streets and porches that have somebody's graffiti, and we're going to be able to say, you got to clean the graffiti off. All the graffiti is going to go. So it doesn't matter if we do it right now, it's too cold to do anything. So as soon as this weather breaks between April 15th and November 15th, you can paint and clean. So we're going to begin that process, and I just wanted to introduce to the communities that that's the foundation of where we're at. Second thing I want to do tonight is give you a chance to ask any particular questions about the process and the program that we're doing, so that Denise and I can understand your concerns that maybe we haven't written into the program. And the third piece, and I'm repeating this very carefully, the third piece is we only want to introduce to you some things that we think we want to do into the future. And they're healthy. We just have to get all the numbers on the page. The mayor knows about these things. And we're going to tell you a little bit about what I'm visioning in my head and how we might be able to partner to help the situation. So at this point, if you have any questions for Denise, fire away. Anything you have a concern about our program, there's the big picture. We're going to be proactive. We started with sweat equity, and we're going to move to codes that will require permits and repairing of property.
When it comes
to, state your name, sir.
I'm Councilman Jason Bear.
Good to meet you.
I live at White 1044. When it comes to the grass cutting, I know some of the reasons you stated why it might not be getting cut is long distance, landscapers, vacancy. But what about the proverbial, an elderly person lives in that house and isn't physically able to cut it anymore?
We'll talk about two options on that, but we already know what we do. Proverbial people, tell us the guidelines that we have followed when there's a repeater in all these, particularly grass and vegetation.
Are you talking about the elderly or just those houses that are like vacant and nobody's cutting?
Right, and we have to write them up twice or three times a year. When we have to do repeats, what do you call?
So the city ordinance says that if our city contractor that works for the city code division cuts the grass three times in a row within a 6 month period, they go on a abandoned list. So then she just cuts it automatically after every 10-ish days.
And then that would get leaned to the ownership of the house or to the city, and then back leaned to the property when it gets sold or gets processed. Yes, can you state your name, please?
Tracy Dupre, City Council.
It's good to have you here today.
Thank you. Money-wise, I understand there's a CBDG or however it's said, loans, short-term loans or low-interest type loans. What if somebody doesn't meet, because those income requirements are quite low. What if somebody's like floating just above that and just can't afford it?
Good question, and I'll address that in the third phase.
Okay.
But, great question. So tonight, again, and every time what we're going to do in the future, going into the next month from now, we'll provide a flyer for the homes that we tag that have a structural issue that needs to be done, so that they know what CBG standards are and how to apply for one. Okay?
Can I ask a follow-up as a point of clarification?
Yes.
So with the process that you just described, Denise, with the gets to a lien part of the process, there's no difference in the process, whether it's a long-distance landlord or there's an elderly person living there that can't cut it. The process doesn't, like,
there is no
recognize any circumstantial difference.
That is correct.
Okay.
However, it doesn't allow us to stop and let the thing grow to another foot and a half, because now that it's a repeat practice, we're now just going to do it regularly ourselves, the city contractor. Can you tell me who you are,
please? My name's Anna.
Hi, Anna.
Hi. I live here in the neighborhood, and I live off of an alley. And they don't clean the alley. I clean the alley, and I'm getting too old to clean the alley. So I don't know when you gave out tickets, because those people never got tickets, because they never cleaned their alley.
So the process that we put our officers through in introducing this alley maintenance program was, the first thing the officers went is they tagged every house that was on an alley. So I'm hoping you got an alley letter.
No.
Great, wonderful. So every house on the alley was supposed to get a 10-day letter saying exactly what he had said before. If you are, if your property butts up against an alley, you are responsible for half that alley. So your street would have got the letter, and the street behind you would have got the same letter. Hopefully. Obviously they did. We'll check into that. So they get a 10-day letter. After 10 days, the officer goes back and they reinspect that alley on that block. If nothing has been done at a particular address, then that particular address, specific address, gets a 7-day letter. So the officers have now given them 17 days to clean that alley. Hold on, hang on just a second.
I got a second part to this.
If that alley hasn't been cleaned after 7 days, and we can find a homeowner or a responsible party to write a ticket to, they get a ticket. And unfortunately, the alley didn't get cleaned, like you said, but there was a ticket at least issued if one was able to be issued. So the alley maintenance letter, unfortunately at this stage of our game, isn't getting alleys cleaned unless the resident does that. Because right now we're not sending our contractor out to clean the alleys.
Correct.
We just think that at this point in time, the cost is astronomical. So we're trying to get the residents to clean the half of that.
Okay, but here's the other problem point to that. Is because on this alley, you have landlords. Like, I can tell you, the one house, it's astronomical. The height of the weeds, the jungle trees, and in the yard are kitchen cabinets all over. We fight rats. I go out there, I clean it. I can only do so much because I'm old.
Agreed.
So, what is going to be done with these landlords?
That'll be back in my park. And I'm glad you can. We're going to fight them and fight them and fight them.
His department being the building department, because his department is both of our departments.
Because these landlords are not keeping up on the properties either, and they get these inspections every couple of years. I'm looking at the house two doors down from me. It's got tarp on the roof and a hole in the roof, and these people are living in this house, and it's been inspected by the city inspectors.
Just have to watch. Once they get passed through the city, and then that house in 3 years dilapidates, and they put a roof and they get damaged, and they put all the garbage in the backyard, and they put all the cabinets in it. Now, because we're not going back to that house as a rental unless there's a complaint or their 3 years term is up. But now that we have a code division that is designed to be proactive, and we know we're going to look at every alley all the time, their responsibility is to walk into that alley, look over the fence and say, wait, I don't care who houses it, it'll be a rental. You fix the roof. But we haven't done permit responsible code violations until this spring. That's why I'm here tonight, to say we're now ready to go into, you have a tarp on that back roof, you have a bad porch, and you're a landlord, you're now going to be responsible because you already are going to lose your violation. We have, the city grants me the right, as the administrator of the building, to take your rental landlord program and dismiss it, suspend it, put it on hold, take your money off your account, if that's as far as we have to go, until you bring your property back to health and safety. And so now that we have a code division who trails all these avenues and these alleys every so many weeks, we'll be able to begin to target those kind of landlords that they'll have to not wait for 3 years to clean up what their tenants have done to their property, but they'll now have to do that on a regular annual or quarterly or half a year basis. So we'll get there once we start this new level of code enforcement that says we're going to stop you from leaving your building in blank condition until the landlord gets to a 3-year cycle.
I have another thing concerning landlords. My name's Sue.
Hi, Sue.
I'm on the corner of Imani and Chandler. And the parking complex that lives across the street constantly goes every 2 weeks that they'll cut the lawn. Then when the idiot guy comes out to cut the lawn, I'm intimidating to them. They blow the grass cuttings out in the street. Now, it's over on my side. Now that's up to me to have to clean up. That isn't right in itself. I've got the tenants complaining to me concerning the way this landlord runs this place.
he hires these guys to do the lawn service, and they do a half
job.
Yeah, I have.
And the problem too is
you did well.
We have to watch because of the flooding.
Exactly.
So we have to make sure the trains are clean.
We were the North End retention basin for a while.
So our street floods, Chandler floods from Sika all the way to the middle of the street. So we're the ones, because we're old.
We used to take oil bars and pick up those sewer lines.
They go out there and clean those sewer caps off.
Right.
But you can't keep doing, we're getting too old for this.
So the process is just beginning. And I'm excited about your concerns, and I'm concerned about you and me being old people who can't keep doing this.
I have another one. This is the city's. Their tree between the street and the sidewalk. Okay? The branches are over my home, over my garage. I called the city and told them these trees need to be trimmed. Well, we'll put it on a list. Okay, how much time to put it on the list? But my house roof is getting destroyed.
Right.
I'm picking up the twigs continuously. It's gotten to the point where I just toss it in the backyard anymore.
I can't answer that question. It's not into my category. However, I do know that we have a separate tree company, contracting company, and we now know that we've been borrowing our own crews in certain seasons of the year to assist that tree company. So,
well, yeah, they too, their butts are lifting up the sidewalk.
And I would replace the violation for the sidewalk, right. But you can't cut that tree down because it's on city property.
Yes, but that's still the responsibility. And until all of the parties in the city can get involved, and line up all the community issues, it won't be a brand new city again. We're talking about communities that.
But they used to go down the street. They used to trim the trees every year.
But you understand, we're now talking about a used to, and that was when revenue and the middle class conditions were here, and the businesses were here, and the population of your DPS was twice to three times that it is now. And until we can get back to that, we have to find the middle of the road of what we're going to do to get there. So each one is a new step backwards to get there. And then we're getting there, but it takes more time because we once were at 50-some DPS that can do that. We don't have that crew left anymore. So we have to work our way back. And so in the meantime, we have to do all the steps we can. And that part of it is helping the homeowner and the landlord particularly clean up the property.
And that's a lot of it is rental property.
It is, and they're out-of-state landlords.
And not all of them.
Not all of them, no.
I know there's a really local one that's just a terrible landlord. He's just, he's a cutting teeth above the rest, but you just have to always watch him. But there are a lot of bad ones. And you understand, you can't see what I see of how many times we are in court with landlords that own multiple homes, and I'm talking over 30, and we're bringing them to court.
And
that takes a long time to bring that culture back.
But what happens when they go to court? Do they get off?
No.
How much time are they given to take care of the issue?
I can't say that because they're all individual cases. So I can't say some of them are ticketed, some of them are given 30 days, but what's the weirdness of it is, let's just say your expiration date was in May of 2021, and now it's 2024, and it's now, but they're already 4 months or a year and a half late. We're not done yet. Let's just go a bit here. Their expiration date was May of 2023. They're still not done. They're almost a year in. When they get complied and the court forces them to be in compliance, their next registration will be in 18 more months, not 3 years from the time they get in compliance. That law changed in 2019 when we won the federal class action lawsuit. We no longer get you don't get to over your 3 years once you get in compliance. If it takes you 5 years to stay in compliance, it takes the court 2 years to get you there, then it doesn't start three more years. It starts from when you paid your registration. So we have that in control. It just takes time to filter out all of them. When I started in the city, we roughly had registered just under 1,400 residential rentals. We're now somewhere around 3,200. So I have a lot more work on my hands to keep everybody in line. What I think will help the rental program is the code enforcement, because now between the three-year cycles, we can control the behavior of the property that the tenant in that home is managing. So we get to patrol that. And that's what's going to help us rebuild these communities piece by piece. We're just 10 to 15, 20 years ago. The trees weren't that big as they are now either. So they're 20 years bigger. So we now have to figure out how to solve those as a city. And that's what I love doing. So we're here telling you we're coming. We're coming with the intent to make people that are lazy or irresponsible or disruptive of the property boundaries that they're supposed to take care of. Because your square is important to the next two squares next to you for the value of your house. And that's why we've asked the council, and they've granted us the right, based on their original document in July 2022, that we could change the code division from reactive to pro. We're just now launching it. As I said, we're 6 months in. It got into the winter. We have no only sweat equity. Now we're going to be letting you know we're coming, knocking your door. Fix your steps, you don't have it. Fix your back porch because you have no rails, that you're over 30 inches. We're going to ask you to put one on, because everybody needs to continue the best to do what we can. So yeah, there's plenty of issues still of why is it our responsibility when the city put the tree there 40 years ago and now it's blowing up all our sidewalks. Those issues are still going to be there for a while. We can't fix all of those, but we can fix what we can. And I'm here to see that we support the people who have done the job well for a long time, and they deserve to be treated by their neighbors or their block with the same kind of integrity. And since they can't do it on their own, the city has granted us the right to enforce that. And that's why we're coming, to encourage you that this is coming, but it comes to everybody. We're not specializing it to a certain group of people. We're not specializing it to just landlords. We're not specializing it to a certain ethnic group. Everybody's going to be treated equally. As we drive through, we're going to find it, we're going to register it, we're going to invite you to fix it, we're going to invite you to get the help you need, and then give you a timeline to get things done in a reasonable time. We're excited about what we can do to help change the culture back to what you guys remember it to be, because it hasn't been there for a long time, and it's going to have to turn around. And that's why Denise and I are on the team, to create a new vision of cleaning up our city. Make sense? Any questions on that?
I mean, it's all great, but I still don't think you're going to get on these landlords.
Well, again, it's
grown up in this area. I've been here 44 years.
So you
We've
know what?
Seen the change. We see what moves in, what leaves, what have you. And we're sitting there looking at all this and going, really? You know?
I understand.
One across the street. Not one, but two people across the street. Porches need to be replaced. I know you mentioned that. You're going to cite them for it.
Yeah.
But we're watching the rats and the mice and everything else in and out of there, going into their siding and coming out. Mm-hmm. And yet we're worried that, okay, they're going to get on our property, what have you. Our property is clean.
Maybe. I haven't seen your property.
We're clean. We're clean.
You
know? Hey, back in the day,
there it is.
City UC even cleaned the sidewalks with this machine.
I get it. But those days and that money and that date of history is gone.
But they don't
they come back. But we as a whole group and a whole community have to support moving the boat in the same direction. We have to row this thing together. We have to get the wind in the right place, put the cells in motion. And that's why when they said, we want you to clean up our neighborhood, I didn't take it lightly. I've asked the city to give money to rebuild the city hall so I could open more space. I asked them to get rid of the LP Pride and split it so that we could come into the city one neighborhood at a time, so that we could start rebuilding the things that have been allowed. And I'm watching. I'm elderly, way into my mid-60s, way past my mid-60s, but I'm there. I just haven't lived in this city that whole time. But I've spent my entire time in urban life helping neighborhoods revitalize. My entire life, 40-some years, I've spent in career in revitalizing neighborhoods. So I'm excited when I see and I go, right. And my colleague will tell you, I don't like what I see sometimes and how I want my train to train my officers. they need to see more than what they see, and we need to help them get there. Because the importance is, what do we bring to the next generation? What do we bring to the seniors that have lived here for 4 years? And what do we bring to the generation that should come here? And so I'm convinced that if we don't start as soon as possible and don't ever go backwards, we won't get to a healthy longevity of a healthy community for the next generation after all of us old people are gone. And so I'd love to make sure we put a plan to make it possible. Let me give you a couple other ideas I have. Go ahead.
I have one more thing. Who's responsible for Ford Street? The apartments along there, the debris that's still sitting there. I called 5 times on a tree that was growing, and it hindered you seeing traffic coming to cross the street.
Mm-hmm. County roads.
Okay, county road.
And therefore, county tree.
That's a
county. I felt like going up there and chopping it myself.
By the apartments, even though they're in like the park.
Yeah. There are state and county roads in our city as well as city-owned controlled cities. So, example, even when we open a new business for somebody, I'm talking building department, when we open a new business and they need a new driveway, they need a approach, and it's on 4th Street, I'm thinking of the pizza shop that had to do their parking lot over, and they wanted a new over there on BC's Pizza.
BC's
Pizza. I said, yes, you're going to have to, and we're going to require you to put one in. But you can't get your permit from me, you're going to get it from my job because it's their road.
Right.
So that's, we have to cross over all these.
So the sidewalk is actually the county, not Lincoln Park?
Right.
Really?
Right. So if they get repaired, so if we do a house, I can think of another one further up on North on 4th Street a year ago that they remodeled and they got approval and they got the designs and they were going to put a small kitchen in behind, in front of that, the black building that's behind the, in front of the church there on 4th Street. And they cut out all the sidewalks. They didn't go get a permit. It was hilarious because Wayne County saw it, and it was their street, and they did not even allow them to put the sidewalks back in, but they fined them 4 times the cost of crossing because they didn't put a permit. So they're much more aggressive than we are when you do step across their property responsibilities. So it's there. We just need to work together to the whole picture. All right? So I appreciate you. Yes,
I did have one question.
And your name is, sir?
My name is Steve Legal, a property owner. You had mentioned fence, and you talked about the charity fence. Are you referring to like chain link fence or wood fences, vinyl fences?
All of them. Example, if a chain link fence is no longer stable, if it's twisted, it's broken, it's disconnected,
yeah,
the gate is falling off,
right,
that's dilapidated fence, and that's, yeah, equal to be repaired, right, removed, or replaced.
Yes. A weathered, rusty, but intact fence, what's,
right,
the committee rule on that?
They'll have to paint. Now in the spring, they're going to be required to bring it back to a condition that nobody could put their hand on it and get a disease from the rust.
I paint my fence all the time.
Do you understand?
I do too. And my fence in the back by my garage,
mm-hmm,
city-owned home on the other side.
Mm-hmm.
Now there's a part where the kid was cutting the lawn, pulled the fence up. Well, it's bowed. Is the city responsible for that one, or am I going to have to take care of that?
You'll probably have to take care of that.
But
the reality is we're not going to be able to prove that. So
right,
we're not going to be able to force that. You won't be able to prove that at this point in the game. So it's you won't be able to prove those things. And if you did, you'd have to prove it at a court to hold that to standard. So being that it's bent doesn't mean you have to replace it. You just have to be able to stake it so it stays vertical straight again. So if you put one stake in the ground at vertical right parallel from the crossbar and you tie it to it, you're probably done. It's not complicated. We'll be glad to give the situations. But there's the answers. Those are all part of cleaning the city up so that the property values stay and rise above where they are presently. That's the answer. Now, we got all the rough ideas out of the way. It's a new beginning. Sir?
Harry Kelsey, 1684 Riverbank. I got a couple questions, John, based on my prior experience. If I call in to Denise and I say I got a violation of a property I'd like to take a look at, do you give me a code number or something so I can follow it up and say, hey, they haven't done it in 3 weeks, Denise, I'm going to give you the number. Could you tell me the status of it?
No, what she's going to do is confirm that it needs to be addressed. She's going to send it to an officer. They're going to clear the field. And once they put it in the enforcement, then there'll be a code number for it.
Okay.
And then if you call back and ask for it, did you get a chance to go visit the site? She'll be able to say yes. Then she can give you a code number to follow with.
I think also you can go BSNA online.
That's
you,
it.
Huh?
Yes, correct.
And look it up that way also.
Yeah, I've tried that a couple times, but I'm not computer literate.
Yeah.
But I understand, I've done it in the past.
But before we...
But that's true.
Now, wait a minute, explain it.
BSNA online.
That's the...
So it's B, S, and then the signal for AN, the symbol A, online, I think it's .com. And you can follow the pattern.
It lists all violations?
You can bring up addresses.
You can look up an address.
Really?
Yep, and see stuff about it.
I didn't know.
I don't know how much information's on there, I don't play with it, because I have the other portion of it. So I don't know what you can find. You know what, since we're talking about that, and you said you want to call in an address?
Yeah, I've done it in the past, and nobody's ever, again, in the past. And I don't know, I look at it for 6 months, a year, and I'm not going over there and hassle the neighbor, and I'm like, what happened? And the neighbor of mine did the same thing in the past, and there was no follow-up. And if you walk by and say, hey, cut your grass, I'm going to give you...
You can call the office, and I can let you know.
That's what I'm asking, because...
But what I was getting at with that point is, being that we're in the computer age, mm-hmm. I cannot take a complaint without an address.
Okay.
And I will do my best to use Google Maps or whatever maps I have, but I can't do, my address is this and two houses to the left of me.
Yes.
Because if Google Maps doesn't hit on that address, you know, where I can bring the camera to that, I don't know what address you're actually, and what left are you talking to? Am I standing at the street looking at your house and it's the left going this way? Or am I standing at my front door looking out the street and the left is this way? Whose left are you talking to? So the computer, the computer, and it won't take interceptions. So unfortunately, we do need addresses to move forward with the complaints.
Okay.
And like I said, I will do my best to find them, but I can't guarantee I will.
But do you keep it confidential if I call in to complain?
If you call in with a complaint, I never ask you for your address unless your complaint is my neighbor's backyard. One of the questions that I ask you is, can you see the backyard from standing like at the sidewalk? If you tell me no, I can't see the violation, my officers aren't going to go, unfortunately, above and beyond and try and figure that out.
So she's going to ask then.
Then I'm going to ask you, okay, do you mind if the officer goes into your yard? You're going to either tell me yes or no. If you tell me yes, then I'm going to take your address, and I'm going to take your name, and I'm going to take your phone number. Because if the officer gets out there and they can't get in your yard, they're going to call you. They have phones. Say, hey, I'm at your location. I'm here to follow up on a complaint. Can I get in your yard? If you don't want to get involved, I can guarantee your problem is going to get solved with your neighbor. Because we don't have carte-blanche authority to walk in somebody's backyard. We can only see what we can see. So if you can only see it from your yard or another's neighbor's yard, I'm going to tell you right now, your complaint's probably going to be unfounded. It's just the way the law works. People have a right to privacy. We can only go so far.
But if you can see it from yours, that's why you're complaining. And you let us in your yard. I did this 2 weeks ago. I went to the house, and they said, hey, you can come to my house. I walked through their living room, went into the kitchen, out of the back porch, and I went and took all the pictures I needed from their backyard.
Oh, I let them go.
And so the answer is yes, if you let us in. But if you don't tell us, we're also bound for your privacy not to reveal who's doing the whistleblowing.
Well, that's what I mean.
I'm not
going to say anything, and I'm hoping the officers on the field are also, if you want them to knock on your door before entering the yard, I'm going to hope they're going to be intelligent enough or confidential enough to say, hey, I'm in the neighborhood, I'm investigating a complaint next door, do you mind if I use your backyard? And obviously you're going to say yes, because you're the one that's, you know, you want them to come in.
But guys,
we try and stay.
When you do the neighborhoods, are we talking driving through the neighborhoods to inspect them or walking the sidewalks to go through the neighborhoods? Because if you're driving, I'm familiar with that. You can't see hardly nothing.
And I modeled it in my office with my officers. And they go, hey, I've been through this neighborhood. And I went, you know what? I'm just going to do my own walk. I'm going to do my own. And I come back with 35 pictures of houses that have violations and run through.
We're hoping they might get out.
And that's so. It's a combination, but it's about making sure that we, and it'll open up. They're going to have to expand their horizons of their jobs because we're now asking them to take care of constructive issues that are problems. Everything else up to this has been sweat equity. Move your trailer, it doesn't belong in your boat in the back, can't be that close to your house. You got to get it out of here because it's a safety hazard. Those are simple. You can't park your back car, you can't open the back gate and put your car in your garage anymore. That's a safety issue for that. But now we're going to be able to say, hey, you have a bad fence, you have a bad roof in your garage, your windows are broken in your garage. You need to fix those. That's a broken hazard problem. So that animals and all the rest of them. Once we get into this, we're now into IPMC, which requires many of these things to have a permit. So we can then make sure that it's installed correctly or correctly removed. And that's why our team has to get more detail on every lot.
We're hoping as we expand, they expand what they're actually looking at, because they're kind of used to just being focused on what they were sent out for the complaint. So as we start to do the little stuff, we're hoping as we expand that they start to see more because we're expanding.
That's right. Brings me another question. You're not working the weekends, right? So if somebody decides to do whatever they're going to do, you'll never catch them because by Monday, everything's back. And I give you an example. There's a food trailer backed up next to the house, residential house. It's got propane and everything else, obviously. And usually on the weekend, they take it out. So, it comes back maybe Monday, maybe not. And when you drive through there, because when I walk through there, I go, it's not here. The next day I walk through, sitting big as rain and right.
And call us.
Well, that's what I'm thinking.
Yeah, that trailer can't sit there on safety reasons.
Yes.
Within 10 feet of the house. Yeah. Because it could explode.
My last question is that you might be familiar with this, but about Evans, next to the Yum Yum Donuts, there's a house for the last 5 years that has been underneath repair, and the court did something, and I'm not quite sure what happened, but it's still sitting there. Basically the same way. And I'm just curious, how do you handle a hard issue?
The situation on that, and I'm not going into details, because our study tonight isn't about detailed situations.
No, I'm just asking.
But I can tell you we're now inside of litigations with attorneys and the court, because the open to weather has been too long to not make damage to the property. So the city's building department has the right to, at certain levels, which I'm not going into tonight, to determine a dangerous building. And we have the right to proceed to remove that from that property or that property from that owner if they haven't managed the property properly. So if it gets too dangerous, we have the right to do something. So on that kind of a uniqueness, yes.
I'm just curious because there are people that are habitual that will play the system unless you keep after them, which is hard to do because everybody spreads thin. And the courts, last time I heard, the courts kept low priority for these issues, and they try to keep 1 or 2 days a week, if even that. So I guess what I'm saying, are the courts on board with this? I mean,
they're processing these? Right, they're more and more. We're now at 3 days that we have cases that are directly. When I got here, they had no days. And now we went to Thursday afternoon, now to a Monday, and then we're now on a Tuesday to Monday, and a Thursday. So it's going to ramp up once we get to construction issues. All right, does that help?
Yeah,
these are just telling you where we're going. We're not there yet. We haven't arrived yet. But if you haven't received it, and these are not quite finished, there's two things on them that are done. But also, we're going to begin every time we get to once it's properly printed. There's one, number 11 is incorrect here. It's both in Spanish and in English, but on this document, if you don't have one, no, I just googled it out. We're not picking on landscaping, but we will be picking on IPMC code. You've already got it in your hand. It comes from the manual in Chapter 3 on exterior issues. We already handed it to you. But the code will be this flyer that will let everybody that we ever walk onto their house know what the city standards are for a quality neighborhood. Here's the 11 things you need to be aware of. You need to be responsible to take care of for your property. So what we've done is we've created a picture in Spanish and English of all the things that is legally responsible of you to take care of. So you go, I don't know what to do. Now you will, because if we ever walk in your house for putting a postal letter on your house, once this is completely correct, we will send and we'll deliver it to every house we walk in. So that you won't be able to say you never had one, because we'll deliver it with you. If you lose it, that's up to you.
But you can't say that we haven't delivered it. So our people will be there. But right now, landscaping won't be on the issue, but roofs, porches, and steps and railings will be a health safety issue. So you're welcome to have a copy of that as you go forward. Okay? So there's the whole meeting in a nutshell that is in phase one and two. And I appreciate all your questions. And you can't be personalized right now because we're just telling you how we're going. Phase one's already been active, sweat equity. Phase two, we're going to begin to look at structural issues and require people to repair, replace, or remove. And on that basis, that's where more and more will happen. And we'll work strongly with the court to go, look, the ticket is there. And these are only going to be civils. So I can't force them to go to court. They can pay it and be done. But what we get to do is watch if they've responded, because we have, watch this, not a complaint anymore. We're proactive. We're actually going back to follow up on what they've done or not done in a timely manner. Once we go practice and they haven't done it, and the court goes, oh yeah, they paid the bill. Good, we're going to give them another ticket. We're going to put that back in your hands, because you get so tired of getting this responsibility, you're going to take care of the job.
What do you have anything to do with the parking tickets?
Pardon?
Parking tickets.
Not us.
No, not us at all.
Not us.
We're not in animals, and we're not in parking. In fact, what we will do.
The trash thing.
Trash day parking is done at the police department. Anything on the street is handled by them.
Right.
They have the capability of towing, they have the capability of leaning, we do not.
So we only take care of the parcel land, the 14,000 to 17,000 that we have. So all the parking is handled by them. In fact, we will borrow their assistance when we have a piece of vehicle in an alley or in the property that's not parked where it's supposed to be, and they haven't responded. And after we've gotten the ticket, we'll work through the details. Then we'll call them up and say, would you tow them? Because we have given them our code requirements, and they haven't complied. Now we're asking you to help us because of your abilities that you have as a police department. We'll take the next step. That stage has not happened yet.
On the city website that we want to report something?
No, you're just going to call the building department's code division.
For the parking issues?
Well, no, for the code issue.
Oh, yeah. Yes. It's the old Pride number.
It's still the old Pride number, but it's not in Pride, it's not your old Pride, it's code board.
Code board. Well, just in case, if something comes up.
Now.
1-800-LP-PARK?
Right. All the things sound crazy, and you might sound awful, but let me close this with a few minutes of vision. And let me repeat it. Let me repeat it to that camera. This is vision. This is plans and hopes of what we can do moving into the future. I know that we have a rental issue in our city. Okay? There's nobody in the city that's more aware, alert, and diligent at working with that rental than I am, because I'm in charge. I understand. I'm not worried about the rental because of it. I'm worried about it because there's human beings' lives at stake. And a lot of people are just tired of the poor people living in our town, and they wish to go away because they're slobs. I'm worried about who's there. Are they taken care of? Because they have the right to be human beings and cared for properly. And so if the landlord can't do it, I will literally have to be in my jurisdiction power to make them take care of those people. So that's part of the case. But on the same side is, the property that we have has to still also be maintained. So I know we have a large rental issue. That means we now have that large of a population that is maybe 28% of our residential is now rental. Okay, I'm doing calculations of real numbers, not guessing. I'm doing what I have as real numbers. So we could be between 28 and 32 as rentals, which means these are not people that can presently afford to own their own home. When I got here, we were somewhere in the 27%. We're now over 58% of our population is in the low mod income. So when you're saying, is there money available through the CDBG, it's growing in the time that I've been in the city. Doubled and plus. So I know that. Watch the third thing I know. So I have a low mod income group of people that may not be able to manage. So when you look at slobs and you don't have all the extra money to do your own this and this and this, you get lazy and you ruin people's property. My job is to make you take care of it.
so that the neighbors who have lived here for 40 years don't have to live with that. That's my job. I understand it. That's why we've developed this. That's why we're creating it. It's not complete. The third thing I know, again, is we have about 30% of my population are retired, single, or retired elderly people that have been retired on a fixed income from, watch this, 12 to 15 years. Their income can't even come close to competing with the inflation of the last 5 years, let alone the last 15. So, and this is not a guess, this is a vision. So hold on, don't tell me, don't go out and write your email and your Facebooks tomorrow morning that John Myers said that we're going to, nope. But the mayor's full aware that we're working very diligently to find other financial resources over and above the CDBG that we can assist the people that legitimately need the help so that they don't get penalized for doing what they've done for 40 years, but have the resources to accomplish what they really dream to do, that they wish they could do, they just don't have the resources. So those programs are in place, in motion. I can tell you at this moment, I'm scheduling, and Denise and I are scheduled to visit with the school district again in the next week or so to address their vocational program, to allow to assist in volunteering manpower from our student bodies to take care of some of the building properties that they can do. We've already made an agreement with them that the building department would be the supervising approvals at the end of their workload. So that would be available to that group, not to landlords, but for those needy people, senior citizens that have been here for a long time that might need that help. I can tell you that we've been in touch with the UAW because there's many, many people in this city that were UAW workers. And so I now have a preliminary interest, strong interest, from before to General Motor in UAW to come and help the city. How we organize those two organizations that are corporate 500 companies to assist us in our 30% of elderly people that really genuinely need the help. That's what we're working for. So as we develop this program to be predictably consistent, I'm repeating myself, predictably consistent on a proactive basis, I'm telling you, as the council and the mayor and the development team continues to push forward, we already have some things in mind and we have some people willing to talk with us about how we consist. We now, I probably need to help write out that program so it goes to the people that most need it genuinely. And so it won't happen, watch this, even giving that money and that resource and manpower to the most needy people won't happen if my code division doesn't do their work first. Because I'm not going to guess who needs it, I'm going to prove who needs it and then provide it for them. Does that make sense? That's the vision we want to take you to the city. It's not here yet, but the mayor can verify that we've already been in contact with these organizations. We've already had other meetings with these organizations. And they're on board to say, how can we help? And now we have to iron out the pros and cons. Hopefully, we'll see if we can help the young generation be understanding that they could be trained, taught, and maybe give something back to the community at an early age to people that have been here and have kept the city effectively alive for a very long period of time prior to them even being here. So we have some opportunities to expand the resources of what we have. They're not in place yet, but I love to think that someday we can finish the game and give many of these three groups of people that are aren't financially well established the support they need to make this city a clean, fun, healthy, safe place to live and occupy again.
See, what you talk about in your vision, I like how it relates to my previous question.
Good.
That is essentially what I was trying to get to.
And that would answer your question, that would begin to give you some direction for where we're trying to go.
And so, a lot of these houses were built in the 50s, a very high percentage. We still did that.
Yeah, it was
so much. So that's where we're at. It's a long way to go, but I wanted to, before we got into money that has to be spent besides that sweat equity to these neighborhoods, I want you to know what we're trying to do. And it will take some time for the development of our program and the city to be prepared for what we're doing. But as you already can tell, in the first 5 to 6 months, we have already clearly isolated that now for the first time in the history that I know of this city, we have a registry of how many resident properties butt up against a alley.
And now we can help them be accountable over the next many years and help the neighbors that are being bad at it do and correct it and be punished or complimented for it. And that's what we have to do, is give the ability to prove the target of people that are failing to do their part of helping the city survive and bring them to alliance with their neighbors who do it naturally. And that's where we're at. Anything else I can answer for you tonight? These are all wide open subjects. No particular detailed address. I hope you enjoyed our presentation to tell you what we've come to do and why we've designed a new program. And we were given the commission by the council to do it. And this is the beginning phase of how to clean up our residential.
When is the next one?
It'll be February the 29th, and it'll be at the Lafayette School.
Nice job, John.
Same time?
Yeah. Meeting just like this?
Yes.
Hopefully, because of this meeting, and you guys have heard some of the things, I won't have any question. You've already been in my grounds before in other subjects, rentals, that it starts small. By the second or third meeting, it's 50, 60, 75.
Well,
so this is the smallest one, and I expect everyone to get larger just because the word of mouth.
It's not publicized.
It should have been on the city website. It's on the big billboard at Southfield and Howard. It was supposed to be on the city.
It is?
The city, Monarchs at Southfield. And the Banchel, I don't even know if that one's running.
It is, both of those, and it's in every one of our buildings.
Should have put signs out.
You're talking about the...